Look at this. So,
in Blake's poem Milton, you know, if you, I mean, the thing about this poem is, well, and the thing about Blake's writing is it's very, very powerful and quite kind of dark as well. So now I'm looking at a random part. This is not the famous part of Milton, where he said, and he also darkened his brows, freezing dark rocks between the footsteps, and in fixing deep the feet in marble beds, that Milton labored with his journey, and his feet bled sore upon the clay now changed to marble. It's as if he's really getting into Milton's mind, and also the torture that Milton went through and the things that Milton wanted to accomplish. And this is seen in the beginning, in the introduction of the poem, which is the famous part. So the part that has become the unofficial national anthem of England. I think we can see it, this one, without the papers, because this version has lyrics. So let's see if you recognize it. Just think that he could get away, like, in a sort of national anthem of England, with having words like the dark satanic mills. Like, the word satanic in a national anthem, but. Bow of burning gold. The arrows of desire. Sorry? Ah, right, Cupidon. These are extremely famous lines. It's like every child in England knows this. And it's... it's like something you traditionally always see at the last night of the proms, and in the Royal Albert Hall, and just knowing the background for this poem is just, you know, it's just amazing, you know, because we're going to read some Blake later. We're going to look at The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, and which is quite a revolutionary poem, and I think you'll see what I mean. But this kind of imagery, thank you so much. This kind of imagery, my chariot of fire, my bow of burning gold. I mean, it's not exactly conventional stuff, you know, and building Jerusalem in England, it's not conventional stuff, you know. You don't hear stuff like that in God Save the Queen, and you don't hear it in, was it the Stadt de Romania? So, well, let's see. So, what we're gonna do? Okay, I think there are only six here. Yeah. So I will not take one, but I will. I will follow it. Yeah. So please pass them around. I'll follow it on my laptop instead. All right, let's see. So we have quite a lot here, and we're not gonna manage to go through it all here, but I you know, for completion's sake, I thought that it would be good for you to have all that, because especially The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, you kind of need to have all of the proverbs of hell, even if we can't do it. Like, if we can't do it this time, I mean, we can't go through all the proverbs of hell, I think. But they are so incredibly famous and so foundational for culture. I mean, I'm sure you know some of them. Like, have you heard the expression, the road of excess leads to the palace of wisdom? Okay, no? Okay, maybe this is just English culture. But this is one of his most famous proverbs, the road of excess.
I believe it was quoted by, I'm so sorry because it's trivia, it's pop trivia, but it was quoted by Jim Morrison from The Doors.
Oh yeah, yeah, good. He was a very big fan of William Blake. And you know,
that's why I know.
and you know where the name of the band The Doors comes from?
The Doors of Perception.
Yes, The Doors of Perception. And where does that come from?
No, this Blake.
Yep, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. That's The Doors of Perception, and we're going to read that part.
Is it the part of the angel?
No. Yeah, the angels and the devil, and. We will get to it. We will get to it. But it is, you know, and Jim Morrison liked that he talked about how you would clean the channel with corrosives. And of course, I think, as far as I've understood from pop culture, I don't know it exactly, but Jim Morrison, or it was interpreted as corrosives as being like LSD, because corrosive is acid, right? So it was like LSD, but of course William Blake was not talking about LSD because it didn't exist at the time. And William Blake did not need LSD for his visions. He was just naturally a visionary. But the corrosives he meant was the corrosives in a printing press, because, you know, he was a printer, and he created these plates. I mean, this is his books of poetry are illustrated like this, you know, with his own illustrations. And it is, I don't know how much of this you're able to see, maybe not so much, Does it become bigger if I move the... Does it? Mm. Okay, well, it is what it is. But we will try to follow it. So, let's see. So you see the first text in the collection is what we just looked at, you know. The countenance divine, what can that be a reference to? Knowing that Blake is a big fan of Milton.
Where is this?
It's the first text in the collection.
Is it the
countenance? Countenance, yeah. I'm sorry, do you not have it?
Oh, I don't.
Okay. So, and did the countenance divine shine forth upon our clouded hills? So, well, what does countenance mean? It's like face, you know, and so do you remember what Milton says in Paradise Lost that we had last time? He talks about the human form divine, and of course from the Bible with man God creating man in his image, yeah, and so. I mean, Blake has these references to Milton, right? The Holy Lamb of God, of course, we know what that is, and we will see it also in the Songs of Innocence. And shine forth upon our clouded hills, you know, I mean, building Jerusalem in England, it's a very idealistic thing, but it's, I think it follows Milton's massive project of justifying the ways of God to man, and doing this in England, you know, the way that he was part of the Protestant or the Puritan movement in England, he wanted to really make a change in society, and well, Blake follows him, but Blake goes more rebellious in his language, even though Milton was a kind of rebellion, but Blake really shows it. So at the end of this preface, which we've just heard sung in the Royal Albert Hall, he has the quotation from Numbers, which is a book in the Bible, one of the five books of Moses. Would to God that all the Lord's people were prophets. And as a prophet, who is he talking about here?
Milton,
I would say, yeah. Okay, so well, last time, of course, we had our big Paradise Lost session. So let's just continue this bridge from Milton with another tribute to Milton, this time by William Wordsworth. And this poem is called London 1802.